Now, we get a little deeper in the sea. You have heard that it was said to those of old, that's what you have heard, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, and that's what you've heard, but I say to you, whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Jesus teaches that adultery is not just the act, but adultery is that which takes place in the heart.
That's it.
No misunderstanding.
Amen.
Ladies, you look at us, it's good looking men. We look at you, it's good looking women. That's not a sin. We've been created by a perfect God.
Yes.
And God makes beauty. He makes a thing to behold. But the Bible says, as I go back to this passage right here in verse 28 of Matthew 5, but I say to you, whosoever looks at a woman, looking is not bad, but he continues, to lust for her. So when the look now begins to uncover, begins to undress.
Yes.
The eyes are powerful.
Yes.
The minds are powerful.
Yes.
Sometimes, ladies, you don't understand that. There are certain ways how some ladies dress only for the bed.
Yes.
You and your husband. When you go outside like that, you don't understand the mind. Jesus says, when you look at a woman to lust, the word in the original means to desire her. And you begin to act on your desire. Now, how does this relate to crime? Once again, this law speaks to respect for marriage. What's happening in our society today? Having a ring on your finger. That is no longer the term. In fact, they love those ones more. That's how it seems. That's how it seems to me. And so, Jesus here is uplifting the sanctity and the standard of marriage. And by extension, the family. When the society breaks down, it is a reflection that the family has broken down.
Yes.
And so if we got back to God's law, if we got back to basic, essentially, we're getting back to what God desires. So, when I have respect for family values, I can behold Sister Barbara. But she is not my wife. You get me?
Yes.
I can admire this person, but this person is not my spouse.
Amen.
And we establish those boundaries. We demonstrate the fact that we have respect. We teach our children to have respect. We teach our young men, based on the word of God, what it means to have respect for a young lady. I want to tell the person, if you love me, you know what the Bible says? Because following adultery, right here in verse 31, is the whole matter of divorce. Malachi chapter 2 and verse 16. The Bible says, God speaking, I hate divorce. Now I'm not here to preach against those of you who may have had the unfortunate experience of a divorce. And I'm preaching the word of God. He doesn't love it. You can see why God doesn't love it. When a divorce comes about, it affects the spouses. It affects the children. The unity is no longer there. The family has been affected. And sometimes this is the occasion when the son or the daughter has a way of going contrary. God says, I hate it.
Amen.
God himself says he hates divorce. But our age and our society, people have little regard for the word of God. So when we disregard God's principle, how can we expect the nation to be healthy? We will continue to try. We will continue to bring in this one and the next one. And nothing is wrong with these things. But we are missing the point. Police cannot police my mind. And your minds. And so right now, if someone has it in his or her mind to do wrong, no police officer can do anything about that.
Amen.
Only the Spirit of God.
Amen.
And then the Spirit of God comes in. The Spirit of God brings about a change, brings about a turnaround. That law abiding or law agency cannot effect per se. I'm not talking about Reformation and what have you, brothers and sisters. They have their places, but it has its place. But I'm talking about a change from within, effected by the Holy Spirit. And if you doubt me, just look at your past. Look at yourself. Let me look at myself. Woman, up for the grace of God and the transforming power of God. We will not be here worshiping today. And so if God can change me and the gospel has this kind of power, then why is not the people of God so worked up and excited and engaged in sharing the good news? Officers. I'm not saying get rid of the defense force officers. We need all of these. I'm not saying get rid of the government. But the point that I'm making, I'm saying let us not pack with these.
Yes.
The people of God needs to present the alternative.
Yes.
We need to present a workable solution in addition to what we have.
Yes.
There is something that is missing in the puzzle.
Yes, sir. Yes.
And it is Christ and his word. It is Christ and his law. Let me move on quickly. Jesus says, going back to verse 20, except your righteousness, that is your behavior, goes beyond and above that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of God. The scribes and the Pharisees are just satisfied to look good on the outside. But my followers, they want to know me. They want to know my will. They want to follow me. They want to be right with me.
Amen.
Now, let's pull it together. Jesus says, as I go to verse 43, let me show you what it means to another level. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Now let me tell you something here. You will search the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, and you will not find a passage that says that. The Bible does not teach us to hate our enemies. What the Bible does teach is that we ought to love our enemies. That's verse 44.
Amen.
Now, if Jesus had said, love your wife, love your children, love the person in your church next to you. That's not hard. But Jesus says, but I say to you, notwithstanding what you have heard, verse 44, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you.
Amen.
Now how do you do these things? He says four things. You are to love, you are to bless, you are to do good, and you are to pray.
Yes.
Now let me tell you something. It is hard to call somebody by name in prayer without having and experiencing a change from it.
Amen.
But you know, you and I may not want to call them by their name in prayer because we know God can change us.
Yes.
It's like the woman who came to the pastor and said, "Pastor, I can't understand what's going on in this marriage. I'm going to divorce this man." Pastor said, "I tell you what, just give me about 4 weeks. I want to try something." So you go home. And what I want you to do everything he likes. Love him. Then, when you have him to a point, I want you to walk out on him. That's the way that you're really going to hurt him. He said, "Pastor, okay, I'll do it." 4 weeks came. She didn't show up. 6 weeks, no show. 2 months, didn't show up. And then eventually the pastor confronted the person. "What happened?" "Pastor, I had a boss in that one." So understand what's going on here. Jesus says, your enemy is essentially your neighbor. Your neighbor is not necessarily someone who lives next door to you, but your neighbor is the person next to you.
Yes.
You know Luke's Gospel chapter 10, the parable of the Good Samaritan. The lawyer stood up to tempt Jesus or to test him and said, "Who is my neighbor?" And Jesus said, "You want to know who's your neighbor?" Essentially, he said, your neighbor is anyone who is in need. Your neighbor is not limited to someone of your own faith, someone of your own complexion, someone who smells like you. Your neighbor is anyone that God has created in his image. Even though he or she may not look it, says that's your neighbor. Now you tell me God doesn't say some things that are hard, but this to another level. He is saying, you've heard that you should hate your enemies. And not only your neighbors, but I say to you, love your enemy, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you. Now, if you hold on there, and you go back with me to this passage, or the first example we gave you about murder beginning in the heart, and in verse 22, I said to you that in the original, the clause, without a cause, is not there. Let me explain. I just read it to you in verse 44. But go back to verse 22. "But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment." When you read that word, without a cause, or that clause, you get the impression that you have the right to be angry. But Jesus is saying, if you are angry with your brother, no, without cause, you should be in danger of the judgment. Now, we're not talking about this type of righteous indignation that Christ experienced. But some people say, "I have a right to be angry with him. I have a right to be angry with him." There's some things that we do to one another and we get one another upset. But this anger is an anger in the context here where you would even murder. So he's not giving you a ground for it as a Christian. I know what you're saying, "Pastor, what about hanging and what have you?" Jesus is speaking to Christians now. The government has the right to administer that kind of a punishment, but we're speaking to the children of God now. His disciples are around. He says, going back to verse 44 again, he says, you ought to love your enemies. How do you love them? You ought to bless those who curse you. Huh? Now, we don't think to do that, right?
No.
Someone who curses you, you want to get even with the person. You want to wish them evil, right? But he says, you ought to bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you.